Hey, this is Scott Clements with OmahaPokerTraining.com. Today we're going to go over five tips to mastering PLO. The first tip is going to be playing premium hands. You want to play premium hands that connect with the flop well and can make very strong hands. Despite the fact that if you look at an Omaha odds calculator pre-flop, that premium hands are not as big of a favorite versus bad hands equity-wise compared to like no limit hold'em, you still want to be playing premium hands that hit the flop well, that can make the nuts or very big hands. You want to draw to the nuts. PLO is a drawing game. A lot of the times, like even if you have top set, you can still be behind. You want to draw to the nuts. You don't want to be drawing to non-nut flushes or lower ends of straights, because even when you hit, somebody can have a higher flush or a higher straight. You want to draw to the nuts. Position is very important. It's even more important than no limit hold'em. You get all the information from all the other players. Now you want to pay attention when you have blockers to the nuts, because this makes it very hard for the other players to continue. If you have like say the ace of hearts on a three heart board, it's very hard for them to just play a guessing game whether you have the nut flush or not. Because if you have the ace of hearts, remember you have three other cards with it. That's a pretty good percentage that you have another heart there. Now also, you want to wait for others to make mistakes. You don't want to build pots with mediocre hands. You want to build pots with really good hands and let the other players with non-nut hands make those mistakes. The first tip, play premium hands. Now, even if you look at an odds calculator, you might see that like, oh, well, this hand, even though it's not very good, and this hand is aces, my equities is not horrible when you look at a scenario. It's not like no limit hold'em. I'm not an 80 to 20 dog or a 70 to 30 dog. I still got a decent chance to win. You still want to play premium hands because it's much easier to play post flop, and you're going to hit much better hands when you're playing premium cards. You want to be able to connect with the board where you can make the nuts. Now you can do this with say high cards. Now you're going to make higher straights with higher cards. You're going to make higher two pairs. You're going to make higher full houses. So higher cards are better. Like an example of a very strong hand, ace, ace, king, king. Those are high cards. That's also like, obviously it's a very good hand, but if you hit a set, you're going to have top set. That's why you want to be playing higher cards. Same thing with like two pairs and everything else. Higher cards are going to beat lower cards. You also want cards that are connected. Straights are very important in Pot Limit Omaha. It's very good to have four cards that go together or are very close together. So when they flop straight draws, you have a whole bunch of outs and also blockers to other people making straights if you have, say, a two pair hand. Good example of this, Jack 10, 9, 8. Now, maybe the board comes 8, 9, deuce. Well, you've got a great hand, but you also have a very good open-ended straight draw. So if they have some sort of wrap, Jack 10, 6, 7, you block two of their cards to make straights with the Jack and the 10, and then you also make the same straight when you do it together. This is why you want all your cards working together. This Jack 10, 9, 8 is a perfect example of a very, very strong hand to play. Now you also want them to be suited. It is great when it's the nut suit, because you always want to be drawing to the nuts in Omaha. So you do want them to be suited as well. I mean, you will still play a lot of hands that maybe don't have the nut suits, similar to this Jack 10, 9, 8, but you want them to be suited because that gives you, not only if there's a flush draw on board, does it give you a flush draw, but if they have a higher flush draw, remember, that blocks their cards. So remember, high cards, connecting cards that can make straights, and suited cards. Especially suited to the nuts. Second tip is you want to draw to the nuts. PLO is a drawing game, but when you're drawing, you want to draw to the nuts. You don't want to draw to the lower ends of straights or low flushes, because then even if you hit, you might not be good. And even if you hit and you are good, you're probably not going to get paid off by anything that's worse. So remember, you want to draw to the nuts. This is why, like, in tip one, you play premium hands. Now, in this scenario, we have king, queen, 5-6 double suited. So maybe we called out of the big blind or whatever. And say it probably checked around and we're on the turn. Now it's ace, deuce, 8-9. Hey, it looks like a pretty strong hand. We've got a flush draw and we've got a gut shot to a straight draw. We've got a lot of outs.
But remember, we're not drawn to the nuts on any of these cards. So us calling a bet is not that great because, sure, we could hit a seven on the river, but that makes us a straight. But are we going to get paid off by anything? A seven could make a lot of, you know, it can make Jack 10 a straight or even 10-6, both of which we're beat by. And I don't think that if a seven comes, we're really going to get paid off of anything. Well, another scenario, guy puts a bet in. Hey, we got a flush draw too, but we're not drawn to the nuts with this flush draw. So even if the ace of spades comes, ace of spades could make this guy a full house. And then we have to play a guessing game on whether to pay him off or a low spade. Sure, it might be good. But if the guy has a lower straight, or excuse me, a lower flush, how often is he going to pay us off? We've got the second nut flush, but we also block him from having like a queen high flush. So how often is he going to just call us with like a jack high flush? Sure, he might, but then we still have to hit the spade. This is why you want to be drawing to the nuts. The third tip is position, position, position. When you're in position, you get all the information from all the other players that are in the pot. You get to see whether they check or whether they bet. And that gives you an indication on the strength of their hand. It also gives you maneuverability. You can maybe raise them on the flop or maybe just call with the nuts. And then they're going to have to bet again whether they improve or not. Or they're going to check to you and then you have the information. They don't have nearly as much information because they don't know your hand. They have no idea whether you are checking or betting. So you just, you have way all the information and you have the maneuverability. Let's go over this perfect scenario of this hand. So in this scenario, we have queen, queen, 10, 9. It's a strong hand. And the flop comes jack, 8, deuce. The guy bets into us. So we know that he has something. Now he can have two pair. He can have a flush draw. He could just have like a bluff, or maybe he has aces. But our hand is very strong here, and it's definitely one that we want to play. But we're not going to raise him because there is a flush draw out there, and we don't have it. So he bets. We just call. Now the turn gives us another flush draw, and he shows aggression again, and he bets another time. Like maybe pot, maybe half pot, whatever. But we still have a very strong hand, and we turned a flush draw, which is kind of disguised. Now, the river comes. Well, we just call on the turn. Now the river comes, the six of hearts. Now he checks to us. We have all the information. We definitely knew on the flop that he probably had a decent hand or a decent draw. And then on the turn, when he continues that aggression, we know that he has a strong hand. Now, we still had a big draw. Now the river comes, the six of hearts. And he checks to us. We have the information that unless he is just going to check with hearts, which is unlikely, but we have that information. So this is a perfect card for us to bluff the river. And we do, but if we're out of position, we have no, like, we're just going to bet into him. And if he has a flush, he's just going to snap call us. But here we have the information that he checked. And especially if we know whether the player would check hearts very often or not, we just have all that information now that he has checked. So it's a perfect chance for us to bluff. Because in his mind, we could have been calling with a heart draw, calling with a heart draw again on the turn, and then boom, the heart comes on the river. So it's very hard for him to call here unless he has hearts. Like even if he had top set or anything else, or maybe if he rivered some sort of backdoor straight, it's just very hard for him to call. So that's why position is important.
The fourth tip is blockers. You want to pay attention to when you have blockers, and you want to have blockers to the nuts. These are very important situations where it's good spots to bluff. And also, like, because even when you do get called, then they have that in their head. So when you do have the nuts, you're going to get paid off more often. But they're not going to call all the time. So you do want to like block when you have like nut blockers. Now, the first, the most common one is having the ace of whatever suit is on board. So in this example, we have the ace of hearts and the flop came all hearts. Now, these are great spots to bet because they're going to just have to play a guessing game whether you have the flush or not. And a lot of times they're just going to let it go because they don't want to, like, if you're betting on the flop, they don't want to call three streets. They don't want to be forced to that decision, like, because by that point, the pot would be very big and they're just playing a guessing game. So when you have that ace on that three heart board, you almost always
are going to bet because remember you have three other cards that can that in your hand. It's very likely if you have the ace of hearts that you have another heart. Even if they have hearts in their hand, there's still a lot of hearts left. So you do want to bet in those scenarios. Unless you're up against a player that just is just going to call with any flush every time, then you don't always have to bet against them, or maybe you bet once and then you give up. Now also, there's this one doesn't happen very much, but blockers to full houses. And this is because in Omaha, you almost always like want to have the nuts. Now I have to have this scenario that doesn't come up very often, but our hand is ace, queen, jack, nine, and we have queen, jack of diamonds. So this is a heads up pot, and the guy leads out on the flop. Well, we have a straight flush draw, and he can be bluffing, and we also, you know, we got the nine, but that's probably not very important, but we do block him having 10-9. Well, if he bets the flop, and then we call, turns a jack. That's another blocker we have, because in his mind, if we call the flop, very likely we can have a 10. So, this point, we block. I mean, he can bet or check, and if we decide to call again, that's fine, because we can still hit a jack or a nine for a full house, and we also can hit a king or an eight of diamonds to have really the stone nuts. Now the river is a queen, and he checks. Well, we block a lot of full houses. Like, he definitely probably, like, if he bet the flop and bet the turn, he's probably got a 10. But even if he has 10-9, he's very scared if we called the flop and the turn that we could have a higher full house. And the queen, we block him from having a queen or a jack. I know it's only one of each, but that is, it is still a blocker to the nuts. And when he checks, these are good spots where you can, don't always have to, but you can put in the bluff. You put in a big bet on the river, it's very hard for him to call. And right now, our hand is just queens and jacks. That's not a very good hand. It's not going to win, but it's very hard for him to call even if he has like a small full house. It's like he could have like the other two nines. Like, so he could have flopped nines full, but in his mind, like, we probably, if we called him twice, we probably have the 10. So these are another situations where you have blockers that could be important. Another third one is another one where it is, we have blockers to the nuts again. Now, in this scenario, the flop comes ace, king, jack. Well, we have queens, but we don't have a 10, so we don't have a straight or anything yet, but we do have the nut flush draw. So when he bets, we're going to call and try to see if we can make our flush. And maybe we backdoor into something else too, but like there's not a lot of strength there, but we're in position, so we're fine. Now the turn's a 10. Well, we have two queens. There's only two queens left. So that's blockers to the nuts. This is a great spot where we can try to take a stab at it and see if we can get him to fold because it's much less likely that he has the nuts since we block two queens. So this is a good spot to make a semi-bluff. We still have the flush draw if we get called, but we also have two blockers to the nuts. So attend to blockers. Don't need to bet them all the time, but you do want to throw them in there because you want to have everyone has to know that you have the capability to bluff. Now, in my other video, you're going to hear me say that beginners should almost never bluff, but these are some scenarios that are good bluffing opportunities as you get more advanced. The last tip of the day is to keep the pot small until you have really big hands. Wait for the other players to make mistakes. Even if you flop top set on some boards, you may be a dog to them. But we're playing in position, so sometimes you might want to just call and let them make a mistake later. So on a flop like King 10-8 with two spades, if they've got a wrap and a flush draw and you have kings, say kings and deuces, you're a dog. Now you don't always want to just call, but you can mix in just calling there because you can wait to see a good turn card. Because not only it also disguises the strength of your hand. If it's a clean turn card, and they say have tens, well, you're going to probably still get like all their money or a big pot for sure because they're not going to believe that you just have kings. And then also, if they have that big wrap and you get a clean turn card, well, maybe they still bet again, but then you can get in the big raise where you're getting a lot of money in, where now you're a decent favorite. That's why, like, you want to mix in those straight calls, and it also disguises the strength. Because in PLO, you have four cards. So players are definitely going to be thinking, like, if they bet the flop and you raise them, they're going to be like, oh, well, he either has a big draw or maybe he has three kings. You want to, like, be able to disguise those hands. So even if you flop the nuts, sometimes you may be behind, but you also can disguise the strength of your hand. And this is where another thing here is this is where people make big mistakes. They just don't think that you would ever just call with a set on a flush board. That's a big mistake that players can make. Now, it's also like you also don't need to c-bet and bluff. You just don't need to do that nearly as much in PLO because you're usually going to get called. Now, you don't want to build pots with mediocre hands. You're going to be playing multiple way pots, and you don't need to build the pot unless you actually have a really strong hand. You don't want to be in there with mediocre hands, and then there's four way to the turn, and then someone else is just going to make the nuts. Pot control. You want to make sure the pot is the size that you want it to be. If you have a big hand, you want to make the pot bigger. If you have a mediocre hand, you want to keep the pot small and kind of see what happens. See if you can make the nuts. In tournaments, it's even more important. In tournaments, you definitely want to play super tight because even if you don't want to build pots and then maybe get all in, because if you lose all your chips, you're just out. And you might get it in as a 60-40 favorite, but that means 40% of the time, you're just out and you can't. So you keep the pot small in tournaments and try to build your stack. But you can also use this, and I like to do this later in tournaments, is where if you get the big stack, then you can put a lot of pressure because the other people don't want to bust either. And this is where, like, if you have a big stack, you want to build the pots bigger because you can put way more pressure on the players. And, like, even though, like, you might lose 60% of the time, you might get folds way more often where you're still gaining a lot of chips. This is my strategy for tournaments is very tight at the beginning until I build a big stack, and then I'm going to put pressure on the opponents, because if you're getting all those folds, you're building chips. So even when you lose the pots, you've already put all that pressure and gotten enough chips to withstand that loss. And then you also have the percentage of the time that you are, like if you're playing a 50-50 pot, 50% of the time you lose, 50% of the time you win, but you have a big stack and you're stealing all these chips, you're still gaining chips. So that's why early in tournaments, super tight, let someone make mistakes. Later in the tournament, if you got the big stack, put the pressure on the other players. Try to win all the pots that they don't want to gamble all their chips for.